What we're going to demonstrate here is some of the data sets that are going to be coming out of GOES-R. So that's why the title is GOES-R, Are You Ready? We start off with the ABI sensor. That's really the main imager that's going to be on GOES-R. You can see from this animation, it's really one of the main instruments. It's the largest instrument, and it's the one that's going to be gathering environmental data, weather data, and climate information as well. All this is going to benefit numerical weather prediction, now casting for forecasting, and also to issue warnings, watches and warnings earlier. You can see it's going to be 16 channels are going to be included on the ABI, as opposed to 5 channels, which are on the current GOES satellite today. And when GOES-R gets up and launched, you can really see the difference here in the imagery. Take a look at severe weather that's moving through. You can see the bubbling cumulonimbus clouds, the overshooting tops. And over on the right-hand side, where it's kind of jerky, is the current GOES satellite today. So with regard to the full disk imagery, we'll be able to see imagery from the full disk, the entire Western Hemisphere, every 5 minutes, as opposed to every 15 minutes and every 30 minutes, between every 3 hours that we see today. So just look how smooth that loop is there, and this is 1 minute imagery. GOES-R is going to provide actually 30 second imagery when it's in rapid scan mode. So it's pretty impressive from an imaging standpoint and the amount of data that's going to be coming across from the GOES-R satellite. So this is a view right here. You can see the red border over here on the east and west side. This is the domain of the GOES East satellite. That's what the GOES East satellite is going to see. And then we can shift over into the west position. So GOES West is going to see this domain. So you can see the United States here. Here's Hawaii right in here. And so out towards the Pacific Ocean. So it's going to offer a lot of image updates, and it's going to be a great view from the GOES-R perspective. Over on this screen, we have a pretty smooth loop of Hurricane Sandy through its life cycle. This was produced by the folks at Goddard Space Flight Center. And this particular image shows a combination of visible and infrared satellite data. So this is the visible part right here, but you'll see as the sun sets like this, then the imagery changes to infrared. So the infrared part is what happens at night, because there's no visible light reflected. As we continue on, I just want to show you a difference in the imagery resolution itself. When we're talking about Hurricane Rita, this was a storm that was in a hurricane that was in the Gulf of Mexico. It was a Category 5 storm at this point. So I'm going to zoom in a little bit, and I want to just show you the difference in the resolution when we talk about looking at the center of the storm. This is the eye of the storm right here, and this is the way it looks from the current GOES satellite. Now, when GOES-R gets launched and the ABI is up and operating, this is the way it's going to look. So you can see the dramatic improvement in resolution, where you can see right down into the eye to the surface of the Gulf of Mexico, and you can see some of the multiple vortexes actually that are rotating around the eye wall itself. It's a phenomenal capability, and one that we'll be able to see every 5 minutes when we have GOES-R up and operating. That's going to revolutionize forecasting. It's going to revolutionize now casting at places like the National Hurricane Center. So I'm going to widen out a little bit, and we'll go up here into the area of Florida. And with the GOES satellite today, it's really tough to see things like contrails and more details in the cloud structures. So this is what it's going to look like in the GOES-R era. As we wipe across here, you can see much more detail in the land. You can see much more detail like plane contrails, where planes are flying. So we'll get much more information, and it's really going to help those local weather forecasters that have to concentrate on their local area. And that's where GOES-R data is really going to make a big difference. So I'm going to back out a little bit here and show you a couple of band combinations. With GOES-R, remember, I just mentioned that it's going to have 16 channels, as opposed to 5 channels that the current GOES satellite has today. Those 16 channels can be combined and merged to produce even more value-added products. And so this is going to be an example. This data here was provided by AER. they put together some algorithms that really can allow us to separate these channels out and produce some of this proxy data that I'm going to show you, because right, GOES-R isn't launched yet, so we're showing you proxy data and information of what the data is going to look like. Excuse me. So we have a number of bands. These are the first six, and these are the different uses that these bands have. For example, band one can be used for daytime aerosol over land, detecting that, looking at coastal water mapping, and all of these uses here are really expanded from the current GOES system today. So here's a visible satellite image of Hurricane Sandy. This was back in 2012, and I want to start to separate out these clouds. So the yellow are the low clouds. So we're not able to do that today by just highlighting low clouds at this resolution and separate them from high clouds. So all the yellow clouds are the low, close to the surface type of clouds here. For example, this strip coming down into Georgia and Florida are all low clouds, like fog and stratiform type clouds. Now, if I want to reverse that and show the high clouds, all I have to do is just do this swipe, and we've changed the high clouds to pink. So if you're looking at a structure where the clouds are evacuating from the storm itself, this is the high clouds. These are cirrus clouds. So the sun's shining through it. It's composed of ice crystals, and the low clouds here are in yellow. Now, if I want to combine infrared satellite data with visible satellite imagery, you can do that as well, because you have all of those bands coming in at once. So I'm going to show you an infrared image. This is Hurricane Sandy as it was closer to the New Jersey coastline, as it was about to make landfall. This is the strongest part of the storm here. And I'll just do a reveal and show the visible satellite data. So the visible part shows the reflected sunlight. All the bumps in the clouds are thunderstorms, and you can see the circulation around the clouds. So it's almost like putting on a better pair of glasses when you have the ABI sensor at higher resolution. You can really zoom down and show this detailed information. And having it at a higher frequency, for example, every 5 minutes, every minute, every 30 seconds, is really going to add a lot of value to the scientists on the research side and also on the operations side as well. So I'm going to continue on. These are the bands that are also available, bands 13, 14, 15, and 16. I'll go back just for a second and show you bands 7 through 12. So you can see low-level water vapor, mid-level water vapor, surface and cloud, fog at night. That's a great product, fog at night. We've never really been able to see that, although some folks that are working with those algorithms have used proxy data like from SUMI NPP to create fog at night products combined with the night lights as well. So that's a pretty spectacular product using some other satellite data. And it's going to be critical to continue to use other satellite data on ground in situ observations, numerical model output. And you know, as the Earth continues to warm, what this is showing are the 10 indicators of a warming world. We have increase of air temperature over the ocean. This is all because of phenomenal research done at NASA, at NOAA, and other areas. Humidity, snow, the average snow cover across the nation is going down, and around the world is going down. Temperature over the lower atmosphere is going up. Global sea levels are on the rise. Air temperature over land is on the rise. Ocean heat content is on the rise. That gives more energy to developing storms over the ocean, such as hurricanes and typhoons. Sea surface temperatures, they're going up, and Arctic sea ice is going down. So even sometimes when you see the Arctic sea ice expanding, it doesn't mean that it's increasing, because the volume of ice is lower. The ice is not as thick, and we'll talk about that in another scenario. This visualization here shows Atlantic City, New Jersey, and what would happen if the sea levels rose by 1 meter. This blue is a 1 meter sea level rise. And so we can start talking about the impacts of this kind of change that's going on and merge GOES-R data with it, because it's higher resolution in temporal resolution, and also in the imagery is higher resolution, going from 1 kilometer today to 500 meters in the Gozar era. So this particular image is when Hurricane Sandy was off the coast of North Carolina. This is some spectacular imagery over here, which is 1 minute imagery of Hurricane Sandy as it was off the North Carolina, Virginia coastline. You can just see the dynamics going on, which is spectacular within this particular storm. The winds coming at low levels around the storm, and then at higher levels going out in an outflow fashion. So we can really see the strength of the storm, see whether it's getting dry air intruded into it, and that will tend to weaken it. But in Sandy's case, as you know, it was a storm that went through an extratropical transition, and that's what really caused quite a bit of damage as the storm was coming on shore. This was the official Hurricane Center forecast at this time of the image, and so we can begin to merge information like GIS data, Geographic Information System data, and then zoom in to higher resolution visible satellite imagery. So I'm going to dive in even further to show you just some of the effects, what happened in Atlantic City when Hurricane Sandy made its landfall. This is a 1 meter satellite image, and you can see what's going on here. This image is actually 6 months before Hurricane Sandy made landfall. The Army Corps of Engineers was involved in beach replenishment in Hurricane Sandy. So you can see the bulldozers that are pushing the sand up on the beach. This is the pipe that's bringing the sand out from offshore. And when the sand comes in, it just drops right here. The water goes back out into the ocean and the sand piles up. So then they bring the bulldozers over and pile it back up. Now, what I want to show you is what it looked like 2 days after Hurricane Sandy. So this is 6 months before, and this is 2 days after Hurricane Sandy. So right here is where that bulldozer was. You can see it's pushing up a lot of sand, and what ended up happening is this is a big cliff of erosion, and so a lot of that sand was washed back out to sea 6 months after they spent millions of dollars to replenish the beach. And so with rising sea levels, a warming ocean, we're seeing much more vulnerability of our coastlines, and that's why COASTR is going to really be a great opportunity to monitor the changes along the coastal environment as well as inland, but it's these kind of impacts that are really going to be important to monitor as we have more coastline that's in the pathway of disaster. And we've seen an increase in the number of billion-dollar disasters around the world. This last image just shows this was in parts of New Jersey. Remember the roller coaster that fell into the ocean. So this is actually, I'm going to make this a little bit thicker here and put it in yellow. This is the roller coaster that went down into the ocean after Hurricane Sandy hit in this location. So you can see all the other rides and everything, and I'll back out a little bit more, but you can see a lot of debris in this area. Here's debris, change this to white. There's debris in here. The storm surge went well inland here. And so again, we have a lot more coastal vulnerabilities and we need more observations such as GOES-R that are gonna be coming, giving us higher resolution and higher frequency, temporal resolution as well. So that's it for this first scenario. Thanks for watching. I'm meteorologist Dave Jones.